I don't think that I have spent this much time in this particular book that I've given this much attention to. I know I haven't recently. I've studied and I've read it, but not like I have as I was teaching this book of James. And we'll just have a word of prayer and then get off into it. Father, I ask you, Lord, that you would open our ears unto your word. And God, Lord, help us to incorporate these things into our daily life. Father, help us to walk in the things that you've provided. And Lord, help our joy to be full. We'll give all praise to you. In Jesus' name we ask it. And amen. Amen. We're in the book of James, chapter 4. We stopped last week on verse 5. James chapter 4 and verse 5. We got through that. So we're picking up in verse number 6. He said, but he giveth more grace, wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. God has more grace than just salvation. And salvation's great, and praise God for great grace that he's given to us in salvation. But God has more grace. You say, how many's ever failed after you got saved? Amen. Every one of us have. How many's ever had the devil, the accuser of the brethren, come to you and tell you, you ought to just give up, you ought to just quit, why you're not doing any good anyhow, and that you're nothing. And then he starts giving a list to you of anything that you might have failed to give 100% or of anything that you've done. And he starts accusing you. He'll use your own conscience. But you say, well, how do you know it's not the Holy Spirit? The Holy Spirit will bring things and show you your fault, but he'll also show you a way up. He won't use it to tear you down. He'll use it to get you to humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. And the Bible tells us here in verse 6 of James 4, but he giveth more grace, wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. God's got grace for every need. If your need is a physical need, God has grace for that. Until you get healing, he'll give you grace to get through it. Amen. Wherever the will of God will lead you, the grace of God can sustain you. Whatever God allows you to go through, God will give you grace to go through that if you'll but look unto him as the author and the finisher of your faith. But one thing he says here, he says that God resisteth the proud. But he giveth grace unto the humble. For the person that would come to God in the spirit of self-judgment and judging theirself, they'll find out he's very present help in time of need. God will help you. If you'll come humbly before the Lord and you'll seek his face and come to him honestly and come to him not trying to pull any shenanigans and not trying to justify yourself by how bad somebody else is doing. If you don't come to God and try to play down, it's not as bad as so-and-so. It's not as bad as this group or that group. And trying to find, it's easy to find somebody that's living worse than you. Amen. It's easy to find somebody that the devil's got a stronghold in and then compare yourself to that. But we're not to compare ourselves to those. We're to compare ourselves to the Lord Jesus Christ. And you always come up lacking if you do that. And it'll always keep you humble. And you always see your need of the Lord in your life. Amen. You would talk with some folk and you would think that they don't even need God anymore. I got it from here, God. I'll do my own thing. God said he resisteth the proud. And there's a reason for that. Listen, those that would come to the Lord and they would come thinking that they're better than anything else or better than somebody else or that they don't need as much grace for their situation as somebody else needs. They're going to be resisted. They'll get no grace. They'll get no mercy. The Bible said that God, and that word resisteth is a military term to where it's going to be with force resisted. You can't come to God and say, like the publican did. I think it was the Pharisee come to him and started telling him all of his qualities and how he fasted and how he prayed and how that, you know, he don't do this and he's not like other men. And God didn't, that man received nothing. Amen. He was resisted. But the publican that had no claim on God, that was a known sinner, that was a known hellion, the publican wouldn't even so much as lift up his eyes, beat his chest, smote his chest, and said, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. And it wasn't that God loved this man more than a guy that was living pretty pure. Now, this other man that came to him, living a good life as far as you could see with the eye. But God don't judge as men judge us. Men looketh upon the outside, but God looketh upon the heart. He looks upon the motive of why you're doing what you're doing, and what is the you know, what's the scheme in behind it. Amen. But he said this, he said, but he giveth more grace, wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. Those that would come to God will be resisted when they come in their own righteousness. The Lord is opposed to the proud. And I think this is because pride is a gateway to all other sins stem from it. Pride is, you know, somebody that's steeped in pride, they can't see their need of God. They're very self-sufficient. They want to be a self-reliant man. And I know all men want to be pretty well self-sufficient. And that's not bad in itself. But it's bad whenever that it comes to spiritual things and you think that you don't need as much grace as somebody else. The fact of it is, the Bible says in Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, and there's none righteous, no, not one. I don't care how godly the person is, they had to be saved from their sin. Amen. I don't care how holy they live, they've got to come daily before the Lord and confess their sins to the Lord and ask Him to cleanse them of their overstepping God's boundaries and failing to do that which they know is right. Amen. So you say, well, why does God hate pride so much? And He does. Listen to what He says in the book of Proverbs chapter 6 and verse 16. He said, these six things do the Lord hate, yea, seven are an abomination unto Him. The first on the list is a proud look, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood. Man, pride's right there with some pretty awful sins, isn't it? He said, a heart that deviseth wicked imaginations, feet that be swift in running to mischief, and a false witness that speaketh lies. And he that soweth discord among the brethren. Out of that list, the first thing he lists is pride. Yeah. And he goes on to say this in chapter 16 of Proverbs. Proverbs chapter 16 and verse number 5. He tells us this. He said, everyone that is proud in heart is an abomination to the Lord. You know what he said? When the man lies with another man, it's an abomination. Puts it right up with queerdom. Puts it up with homosexuality. It's an abomination. God hates pride. You look up the word pride, and it's somebody who thinks that they're superior, whether it be in service or whether it be in... They've got a high value of their own self that's better than somebody else. And the ground is level at Calvary. At Calvary, we're equals. Amen. And we all have the same need. We need the Lord. Amen. And you say, well, I'm saved. Well, you still need the Lord. Amen. I need Him to stay in. I need Him for my strength. I need Him for the Bible said, the very air that we have is God's mercy and grace. The very air in our lungs, God, all life is sustained by Him. It's from Him. And everything is to be to Him. We are to give glory. And we were made for His pleasure and for His glory. And we ought to glorify the Lord. Amen. He tells us in verse 18 of chapter 16 of Proverbs. He said, pride goeth before destruction, and a haughty spirit before fall. You don't have to have a lot of stuff to be boastful. You don't have to have a lot of money to be greedy. Amen. You'd be surprised how many people are are proud and greedy. Them things just sort of fit like that. Amen. And it's amazing. And you say, well, what is it? Pride is a gateway sin. Yep. Buddy, it's one of them. It's one of the first things. What did he say to Satan? Where did sin originate? Somebody tell me where.
Pride.
Yeah, but where was it?
Heaven.
Is in heaven.
Yeah.
Amen. What was the first sin?
Pride.
God hates pride.
Yep.
It's a gateway thing, man. Somebody proud thinks that they don't need, they can't see their need. They think they're doing pretty good. As I've studied this, there's been some times that I felt like I was close to the Lord. And looking back to where I was then, God, the Holy Spirit said, this is where you was. This is your attitude. This is how, and he was just showing me I was as crooked as a barrel full of fish hooks. Why couldn't you see it, preacher? Pride.
Amen.
I don't have anything that you can see to be proud of. Amen. But there was a preacher friend of mine brought out a message. He preached a message on pride. And nowhere in the Bible is being proud spoke of as a positive thing. Amen. I mean, everywhere that you see pride, it has a negative connotation to it. And you say, well, why can't you be proud? Well, you can be pleased with somebody, but just don't be proud of them. Amen. Not in the biblical sense as it is. The Lord Jesus tells us in Matthew 23 and 12, in Matthew's Gospel 23 and verse number 12, he said, and whosoever shall exalt himself shall be abased, and he that shall humble himself shall be exalted. God said, I do the exalting. He raises one up, he sets another down. God places one, he removes one. You say, who does it? God does it. Well, what if they're not willing? You think they can stub up on God? The one that holds the very air they're breathing? When God gets ready to do something, who can stay his hand? When God changes, amen. Amen. I've had people come through this church. When they come, they said, praise God, this is where God wants me, this is where we're going to be. And then they stay for a little while, poof, they're gone. And somebody said, don't that make you mad? And I said, no. And they said, why? And I said, well, evidently this wasn't where God wanted them. Amen. Amen. It was a blessing while they was here. I've seen people get mad at people because they leave the church that they're going to and won't even speak to them. That's crazy. They had nothing changed as a relationship. We're just not serving together at the same place. That don't mean we're enemies. You have one enemy and it's not anybody in Christ. Amen. Anybody, that's right. It's the flesh, the world, and the devil. That's our enemies. Amen. James is trying to point some things out here on practical Christianity. Things that'll help you in your everyday life if you'll but step back and look at yourself unprejudiced. Amen. And look at yourself the way you look at others. And look at your motives. That you can't tell other people's motives, but you can tell your motives. You know why you do the things you do. You know why you don't do the things you do. Amen. And by the way, the singing tonight was a lot better. Amen. It was good. And we ought to glorify God. He is worthy of your best. Amen. You say, why? I had somebody say, well, I can't sing well. Well, just do the best you can. Amen. And give it your all to God. Whatever you do, do it as unto the Lord wholeheartedly. Give your best to Him. And if you're giving your best, that's all God asked. Amen. He don't ask me to sing like somebody that's got a $1 million voice because I don't have that. But I got a heart that's full of joy and a life that's full of thankfulness, and I ought to give that kind of praise unto Him. He inherits the praise of His people. Amen. So James tells us, he said, but He giveth more grace. When does He give more grace? When you need it.
Amen.
Amen. That's exactly right. He gives you just what you need. Amen. He knows what you need. There's some times I've went to the Lord and I've spread out my issue before God and I've told Him what I think that I need and how I think it ought to go. And it never is right, except for the part I had a need. That part I got right. But the how I thought it was going to be handled wasn't the way God handled it at all. And you know what? I thank God that He did it His way. Because if He'd done it my way, it'd have been a mess. And God's able to do all things well. If you may feel like you're in a impossible situation, you may be listening by way of internet, you may be here in the congregation and think, man, I'm in an impossible situation. I don't know how to fix this. I don't know how I'm going to get through it. God will give you more grace. Amen. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint. You got to look to Him and you got to trust Him and say, Lord, not my will but thine be done. And then wait on the Lord. They that wait on the Lord shall have their need met, and it'll be met greatly. In verse number 7, He tells us this. He said, submit yourself therefore to God. To submit is to fall in rank. What does it mean to submit? It means to fall in rank. When I went to the military, I had to submit to my drill sergeant. I had to fall in rank. He's boss. He's straw boss. Amen. And you had to do what they said, when they said, how they said. They told you when to eat, when to sleep, when to get up. They told you on what kind of clothes you were going to be wearing, when you was going to wear certain things. They were the commander in chief. Well, the Bible says that Jesus Christ is the captain of our salvation. And we are to submit to the Lord. And it's amazing. People want salvation with no responsibility. They want salvation with no accountability. And friend, with the great gift of grace comes a great responsibility of falling in rank. He said here, He said, submit yourselves, therefore, to God. To fall under the leadership and the authority of the Lord. And if God's displeased with it, you need to line up with what pleases the Lord. And you don't have to, a lot of people, they want to say, well, your hair's got to be a certain way. They say you can't wear a certain color or a certain kind of glasses. I'm just saying this, it ought to be pleasing to the Lord, amen, and to work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Didn't say work for it, He said work it out. Once you've believed on the Lord Jesus Christ and you've received mercy and grace of the salvation of the blood atonement of the Lamb of God, once that happens in your life, you are to submit yourself to God and to fall in rank and to be able to serve Him because He is our Lord. Amen. What did He say in Ephesians 2:1? And you hath He quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins, which you walked in time past. You've been quickened. You've been made alive. You no longer have the spirit of the spirit of the world that worketh in the children of disobedience. God has given of His Holy Spirit to us. Amen. He's baptized those that's trusted the Lord Jesus Christ into the body of Christ. And we are to follow His Spirit. And His Spirit is in alignment with His Word. The Holy Ghost will never contradict the Word of God. The Spirit of God will never lead you contrary to the Word of God. Amen? He'll lead you in unison with the Word of God. As a matter of fact, He'll make things known unto you. He'll open up the Scriptures to you, and He will bless you in the Word, and He'll wash you by the Word. Turn with me, if you would, to the book of Luke, chapter number 18. I wasn't going to go here, but in Luke 18:9, if you'll remember, the Lord spake a parable unto a certain which trusted in themselves that they were righteous and despised others. He said, two men went into the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a publican. And the Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself, God, I thank Thee, I'm not as other men are, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this publican. He looked down, he saw somebody had no claim on God, that probably wasn't dressed too well, probably didn't have any of the religious garb, didn't have the praise the Lord, hallelujah catchphrases. We talked to some people that know some things about God. You can know a lot of things about God and not know God. Amen. Jesus said there'd be preachers on the day of judgment that's going to say to him, Lord, Lord, in thy name have we not done many wonderful works? In thy name have we not cast out devils? In thy name? Amen. But they didn't know him. They got affiliated with some church somewhere. It amazes me. People say, well, the Baptist is right. And the some of the meanest people I know are Baptist. Amen. I know more Baptists than I do any denomination, so it's only rightly so that I would know a lot of the mean ones that are in there. He's not coming for a Baptist. He's coming for a blood-bought child of God. And I'm not running the Baptist down or the Methodist down or any other tag you want to put on yourself. I'm saying this. What have you did with Jesus Christ? Is there a point in your life to where you received Him, to you, that you believe the gospel, the death, burial, and resurrection, and you trusted what was done on Calvary to pay for your sin, and that you believe that He rose from the dead the third and appointed day, and you hope and trust is in that. You believe the record that God has given of His Son, and you did what it said. You called on Him. You confessed that you were a sinner. You ask God to forgive you of your sin, and you ask Christ to come into your heart and save you. Now, let me tell you what I prayed. I don't remember exactly what I prayed, but I remember praying this, Lord, I'll serve you. Anybody else pray and tell the Lord you'd serve Him if He'd just save you? Are you serving Him? Amen. Don't you think it's only rightly so if He saved you from a devil's hell that you would want to be under His lordship? Isn't it rightly so that if God would have mercy on you and make you a child of God from a child of the devil, that you would want to serve Him and please Him? I promised the Lord, I'll serve you. I've broken that promise so many times. I didn't set out to do it, but just the nature, the Adamic nature keep rising up. Amen. Sometimes I've did it ignorantly and sometimes I've done it foolishly. But we all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. This publican says this. He said, I fast twice in a week. Anybody in here fast twice a week? As far as the religious duties, he got everybody in here beat. Amen. You fast twice a week?
Every night, preacher.
Yeah. Yeah, amen. Everybody tithe on all they possess. I can say amen to that. And the publican standing afar off would not lift up so much even as his eyes unto heaven, but smote upon his breast, saying, God be merciful to me, a sinner. He come to God honestly. That's what the Lord is showing. Just be, if you've sinned against God, don't try to say, Lord, I didn't do as bad as Jake did over here. I know I sinned, but I ain't as bad a sin as Tom. Look what he's done. Tom's got nothing to do with you. God won't ask you about Preacher Mike. You're going to be giving account of yours. I had a lady tell me one time, she got mad at me as the pastor of this church and stormed out. And she said, I'll see you at the judgment seat of Christ on this. And I said, if you make it to the judgment seat of Christ, you won't be looking at my record. You'll be looking at your own. Amen. Amen. I'm not so sure. And I'm not God, so I can't say. Amen. But there's going to be a lot of people that say, Lord, Lord, that never knew Him. Amen. There's going to be a lot of folk that has the name saved in Christian that's never been saved. There's been no change whatsoever. Amen? And there ought to be a change. And God said there would be a change.
Well, that's the truth too.
Amen. And the Lord is opposed to the to the proud. And we covered why he is, but I want to say this. God has grace for every need that you have. I don't care what your need is. You say, preacher, you just don't know my situation. God does. Amen. Amen. There's a lot of things I don't know. There's a lot of things you don't know. But there ain't one thing that God doesn't know. Amen. He knows it all. Every bit of it. I mean, nothing lacking. When somebody comes and they try to justify themselves and try to make it, you know, don't sound so bad, and try to build theirself up and step on somebody else, God never does that. Amen. When you come to God, He sees as it is. That's why when that publican came and took his place as a sinner before God, if you have failed God, just tell Him, say, Lord, I sinned. I sinned against you and against heaven. And if you'll be real with God and be honest with God and be humble before God and want to have reconciliation, God will give you grace to get back in fellowship. God will give you grace to grow as a child of God. God will give you grace to rise above the storms that are in your life. God will give you grace to be able to be overcomer in whatever situation you face. Now the devil, he'll try to steal, kill, and destroy. But he said in 2 Timothy 1:7, God didn't give us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. Don't let the devil mess with your mind. He'll paint you an awful picture, tell you the church is going down, falling apart. Jeff was witnessing to this guy trying to get him to get back in church. And he said, churches are closing up and they're falling down. There is a lot of them close the door, but the church is going up. There's a bunch of them quit having church on Sunday nights and Wednesday nights. That ain't changing a thing. That's just little independent people. The body of Christ is going up. Amen? Not one of God's promises have been altered. Not one of God's graces have been withdrawn. God is that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And your situation isn't going to change that. But if you'll go to Him, He has grace for that need. He has grace for it. Preacher, I just don't think I can make it. On your own, you can't. But if you'll go to God, He'll give you grace. Amen. God has grace. In James 4:7, He tells us this. He said, submit yourself therefore to God. Resist the devil, and he'll flee from you. You know what resist is, don't you? Resist don't mean talking to the devil or any of his henchmen. You probably won't see the devil, but maybe one of his representatives will come along and tell you that God don't expect you to go to church, and God don't expect you to read the Bible, and God really don't expect you to pray, and it's okay to do a little of this and a little of that, and it's okay. You just, you know, you can half step and be part-time and just get by fine. But let me tell you what'll happen. Your joy, your peace, and it won't be long till your hope begins to dwindle. Amen. The devil, according to Jesus in John 10:10, he come to kill, to steal, and to destroy. But Jesus said, I've come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. In 1 Peter 5:8, Peter gives us this same warning. He said, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil. And when he says sober, he's not necessarily talking about being sober off of alcohol. He's saying be sober-minded. Think right. I'm sure it takes in alcohol as well. Amen? But there's a lot of people who never touched alcohol that's not sober-minded. Amen? And he said this. He said, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, you have this thing is real, the devil. He said, as a roaring lion walketh about seeking whom he may devour. He said, whom? Resist steadfast in the faith. How do you resist steadfast? You don't go along. He said, my son, if sinners entice thee, consent thou not. Don't consent with them. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. How do I resist him? In the faith. You say, how do you resist the devil in the faith? You rebuke him in the name of Jesus Christ and you draw nigh to God and he will draw nigh to you. When an eagle gets attacked by a predator bird, there's not too many predators that can overcome an eagle, but there is some that do. What that eagle will do is he'll turn and fly straight into the sun. And God has blessed that eagle with a built-in set of sunglasses that'll fold down over his eyes, and he's able to fly straight into the sun that the predator birds don't have. And when they follow him so far into the sun, they go blind and have to break off. Well, let me tell you something. God compares us to the eagle. Amen. And he is, if we'll just run to the S-O-N and begin to draw nigh to God, you'll find out, friend, it won't be long until your enemies and those that would disturb you. I was talking to some and they said, I just can't stand it when these people come over. And I said, well, tell them to leave. Well, I just don't want to be rude. And I said, well, start talking about Jesus. Fly into the sun. I guarantee you they'll either get right or get gone. Amen. They tell us over there, said, every time you all come over here, all you want to do is talk about God, talk about Jesus, talk about church, talk about praying, talk about somebody being saved. That's all you want to talk about. That tells me whose side they're on right there. Amen. But he tells us, he said, whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren. It ain't just you that's going through trials. A lot of people going through trials. I went to somebody one time and I thought I had a trial, a burden about as big as this pulpit. And they sat and listened and they prayed with me. And then I talked to another guy and said, you know that they're going, and they told me what they was going through, and it was as big as a church. And I had this little thing. And they didn't start telling me what they were going through. They just prayed with me and helped bear my burden. And you say, how could they do that? The same grace that was sustaining them, they called on to help sustain me.
That's right. Amen.
God is able. He's got grace for every need. He's got grace for every need. Amen. In 1 John chapter 5, verses 4 and 5, he says this. He said, for whosoever is born of God overcometh the world, and this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. The devil will say, you're not going to make it. Faith says, I can do all things through Christ which strengthened me. The devil says, you're a failure. But faith says, it lays hold on the promises of God. You're more than conquerors through Him, through the Lord Jesus Christ. What does he say in Romans chapter number 8? In Romans chapter verse 34, he said, who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation? No. Or distress? Persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. The devil will say, you're going down. I'm going up. The devil will say, you're not going to make it. I'm already seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. My name is written down on a white stone in glory. Amen. I am a child of God by birth and adoption. Amen. And I have an inheritance that's incorruptible, undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for me. And I'm not going to get bumped out of it, cheated out of it, robbed out of it. It's not, thieves can't break through and steal, and rust and moth can't corrupt. Amen. It's reserved. Not just for me only, but from all them also that love His appearing and that know Him in the free pardon of sin. James 4:8 tells us this. Well, let me read this verse 5 in 1 John 5. He said, "Who is he that overcometh the world but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God?" Is Jesus your Savior? Is he the Son of God? Is he God the Son? Yes, he is. Is he alive forevermore? Is he coming back just like he said? How long? Yet a little while, and he that shall come and will not tarry. Hebrews chapter 10 tells us that, and I think 32 or 34. James tells us this in verse 8. He said, "Draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you." If there is somebody that will draw nigh with a earnest heart, the Lord never refuses to meet any who sincerely seek His face. As a matter of fact, He tells us in Hebrews 4 and 16, "Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need." You got a need? Well, you got one that's willing to meet it. You need more grace? Let me tell you about the God of all grace. Amen. All you got to do is, you know what will happen? The devil will take your confidence away in God. Devil will say, "God won't do that for you. Look what you did. God won't do that for you. You failed him. God won't do that for you. He's a liar and the father of it." And the reason he don't want you praying is because that's where your help comes from. Your help comes from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. Therefore, he don't want you lift up your eyes into the hills from whence comes your help. What he wants you to do is give up. He wants you to quit. Because if he can get, just like a lion will charge a herd of sheep or elk or venison or whatever it is, and they'll catch a wounded one or a weak one, and they'll get it away from the herd, and then it's a gazing stock for the devil. Amen? Sheep's the dumbest animal they is. They can be a coyote after two sheep. And I think the brother that was here preaching, he said, the coyote, will, while he's killing one, the other sheep will run around circles until he gets done with that one. Waiting for his turn. They have no defense. Their teeth are not made for defense. They are totally reliant on the shepherd. And friend, that's what we ought to be. Totally reliant on the shepherd. And therefore unto him we should cling and run. So he tells us in verse 8, he said, "Draw nigh to God and he will draw nigh to you." You ever went to God hurting? Went to God desperate? Went to God broken? Went to God when ain't nobody else would let you come to him? Went to God when you had nobody else to go to? And he received you? And he restored you, and he blessed you. Well, he's still the same. He said, "I, the Lord, I change not." Amen. He changes not. Only thing changes is the devil can destroy your confidence and hope and get you not to pray and get you not to come. Because you are invited and provision has been provided. In Psalms 24, turn there if you would. Psalms 24. Psalms 24 and 1, the Bible said, "The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof." I don't know what I'm going to do. I ain't going to be able to make it. I'm going to just surely lose everything I have, and I'll starve to death. That's the devil. That's unbelief, and it's the flesh. "The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof." He said, "The world and they that dwell therein." Let me tell you something. I could not provide for myself because I'd broken both of my elbows. Broke them right back there. I was painting this church and somebody had put some plastic down as I was getting off of a scalpel. I stepped on that plastic and that's like fox on wheels. I went completely somersault. My feet went up and I went down and landed on that hardwood floor and crushed both my elbows. I couldn't work. I couldn't eat. I had bills. I had lost all my ability to supply for my family. I didn't miss one meal. I didn't get behind on any bills. You see, the earth is the Lord's and all therein that dwells. God just said, I want you to go and give Mike Earl this. I want you to go and buy them this. I didn't tell them. God had people I went to school with that wasn't even saved when I knew them. We were both lost and had a complete, he might as well, I knew who he was. I hadn't seen him in 20 years. Pull up to the house, blow the horn, have me a check. And not just one person, people from all, I mean people I hadn't even thought of since high school. People I, and some of the people I didn't even know. Show up. Now, I wasn't calling people saying, I don't know what I'm going to do. I was just praying, God, please help me. Lord, I don't know what I'm going to do. Lord, please help me. And you know what he did? He helped me. Amen. You know what he'll do for you? He'll help you. But you got to look to him. He said, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. For he hath founded it upon the seas and established it upon the floods. Who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord? Or who shall stand in his holy place? Here's, now listen. He that hath clean hands and a pure heart, who hath not lifted up his soul unto vanity, nor swore deceitfully, he shall receive the blessing from the Lord and righteousness from God, from the God of his salvation. He's saying, if you come to God earnestly, come to God honestly and humbly, God will help you. You say, but yeah, but I messed up and it's my fault. God will help you. Amen? I can't tell you of the people I've seen Satan get a advantage of that were taken captive of him and just about destroyed. But they humbled themselves and came back into the Lord and came through this church, many of them did. And we helped nourish them and nurture them back to spiritual health and prayed and ministered and labored together and worshiped together, and God restored them, and then God sent them back out. Amen? Why? Because you're something? No, I'm a sinner saved by grace. Amen? But this church is a beacon. And friend, everybody in it has a part. Are you doing your part? Amen? I mean, if somebody else don't do their part, that means somebody else has to pull their part and part of your part. Amen? Everybody's got a part. There is no insignificant parts of your body. People say, well, you can get by without the appendix. You can't get by as well. God put them in there for a reason. Or you can get by without this. Your body might be able to function, but not like it would if it was all healthy. God made the body and he made it proper and he put everything in it that was needful. You can get by without one eye, but not as good as with two. You can get by without hearing in one ear, but it handicaps you. And every body, every member of the body of Christ is important and has a part. And you know what? To the parts that, the way people is, they say, the pastor. The pastor's a man. He's a sinner saved by grace. Amen? He's God's man. He ought to be. He better be. Amen? But the fact of it is, without the congregation, the pastor wouldn't be able to pastor. He'd have nobody to pastor. Amen? Amen. James tells us this. He said, well, just let me say this. You must be honest when you approach the Lord. I mean, when you talk to him, don't come trying to convince God to see it your way. Amen. That's one person you got to be honest with. Turn with me to Psalms 145:18. Psalms 145. I bet that's not it. Yeah. The Bible said, "The Lord is nigh unto all them that call upon Him, to all that call upon Him in truth. He will fulfill the desire of them that fear Him. He also will hear their cry, and He will save them." And all of the God's saving isn't just saving of the soul. Yeah, He'll save your soul. That's the main thing, but He'll save your life. Amen. He can save you from trouble. He can save you from fear. He can save you from a lot of things. But you got to look to Him and you got to be honest with Him. In verses 9 and 10, I don't know if you're getting a blessing out of this, but I'll tell you what, James has helped me personally. Verses 9 and 10, he said, well, let me read this, the last of verse 8. He said, "Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded." James is giving a call to saints and sinners to repentance. Amen. Basically, he's just saying, you need to repent. What was the message that Jesus sent the disciples out? That repentance and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Repentance is a word that much of the church thinks is a swear word or something, or a cuss word. You tell somebody to repent and they get mad at you. Like, you're judging me. No, I'm just saying what God says. From the pulpit to the back row, we all have to have a repented heart and a repented life. Amen. In 1 John, he said that if we confessed our sin, He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Old and New Testament. Listen, in Isaiah 55, in Isaiah 55 and 6, God said, "Seek ye the Lord while He may be found, and call upon Him while He was near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return unto the Lord, and He will have mercy upon him, and to our God, for He will abundantly pardon." God said, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord." Let me tell you how man does. Man said, "Let me clean up first." You try to get them to come to Christ. "Well, let me quit. I'm drinking. I've got some sin in my life. Let me get my sin straight." There's the problem. You can't cleanse yourself from sin. I can't cleanse myself from sin. We got to come to God and let Him do it. You just come dirty. When you get home from work and you get ready to take a shower, you don't wash off at the sink before you get in the shower, do you? You just get in dirty and clean up and get out clean. And that's the way you got to come to God. You got to come guilty. You got to come honestly and earnestly and humble, knowing that He's your only help. He's the only one that can. God said, "My thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord." You can't clean up clean enough to come to God. I understand you don't want to come to God swearing and cussing. And you wouldn't do that, but it's in there. There's a lady at these apartments I'm working at, and she sang gospel music and was in church much of her life, and now she's got Alzheimer's and will cuss the wallpaper off the wall. Yep. "Oh, that's terrible. She'll go to hell. She's lost her mind." Yep. She can't tell you what she said to you 2 minutes ago. She'll say, "Hey, where do you live?" And you just told her where you lived. That's an illness. Yes, He does, sister. Yes, He does. He gives more grace. But what I'm saying is this. It's in there. That woman didn't use that kind of conversation. But it's in there. Guess what? It's in you too. "Oh, not me, preacher. I ain't never." Well, you've heard it. And it'll come out. Amen. You lose your mind, ain't no telling what you'll do. There was a preacher. Amen. There was a preacher, pastored a church for years and years. He got Alzheimer's. The guy told me he went to see him in the nursing home, and the guy just cussing and swearing something awful. And they'll say, I wonder if he's doing that all the time. No, he wasn't doing that. It's in you too.
Right.
It's in there. God said this, he said, for as the heaven is higher than the earth, so are my ways than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. He said, for as the rain that cometh down and snow from heaven and returneth not thither, but watereth the earth and maketh it to bring forth and bud. He's saying the rain accomplished the thing, its purpose, it's doing what I created it for. He said, that it may give seed to the eater, and seed that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereunto I sent it. His word will do the same thing.
Yeah.
The same word, the same word that's sent out for salvation will be your judge if you reject it. You see, the same sun that melts the wax hardens the clay. And the same word of God that goes out for salvation and a lifeline will turn around and be your judge if you reject it. So James is sending a call out. We must come with a repented heart. And Paul says that in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse number 31. 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 31. What time is it? I'm about ready to close here. Chapter 11 and verse 31. He said, for if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we're chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world. God wants us to have a repented heart and to judge ourselves. And to come with Him with a repenting heart. In 2 Chronicles 7 and 14, God said, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and turn, there's repentance, from their wicked ways. Then God said that He would do some things, that He would hear from heaven, that He would forgive their sin. He said, except you repent, you shall all likewise perish. In James chapter 4, verses 11 and 12, he tells us this. He said, speak not evil one of another, brethren. He that speaketh evil of his brother judges his brother, and speaketh evil of the law and judges the law. But if thou judge the law, thou art not a doer of the law, but a judge. He said, there is one lawgiver who is able to save and to destroy. Who art thou that judgest another? Now, we all know this, but how quick we forget and let it slip. Now, I know you're to have righteous judgment. You're to judge whether something's right or wrong. You're to judge whether somebody is spiritually correct as far as their actions go. You can't judge their motives because you can't see that. If I were to step down here and me find somebody and were to smack one of these kids, you'd see that I was messed up for doing that. I was going to say smack Donnie, but he'd cream me. Amen. But what I'm saying is, the thing of it is, those things you can see, but you can't see motive inside the heart. But you can tell if somebody's right or wrong in what they're doing. If somebody come in here drunk as a monkey and showing theirself, it would not be wrong to judge they're not right with God. That's just righteous judgment. And there's some things that we ought to judge, but to judge whether somebody is right with God as far as their salvation, only God can judge that. Amen? And he says this, and he said, but we're quick about judging one another. We're quick about biting and devouring one another. Amen. Even before you hear the whole matter, first thing we are to do is to try to think the worst. He said, speak not evil of one another, brethren. He that speaketh evil of his brother judges his brother, and speaketh evil of the law and judges the law. But if thou judge the law, thou art not a doer of the law, but a judge. There is one lawgiver, that's God, who is able to save and to destroy. Who art thou that judgest another? And he says this about that. Paul addresses this very same thing here. Paul tells us in Romans chapter 2 and verses 1 through 6. He said, gosh, I went over. He said, therefore thou art inexcusable, O man, whosoever thou art that judgest another. For that wherein thou judgest another, thou condemnest thyself. How many's ever judged somebody for something you've been guilty of? Just not on the same degree they were. You didn't do it just out openly. Maybe it was at home. Maybe it was in your heart. Boy, you can sure tell them what they done wrong. And we know we're not supposed to do this, but how quick do we forget? Amen. Very quickly. He said, but we are sure that the judgment of God is according to truth. I think Solomon said, though a sinner transgress 100 times and don't seem to be, seems to get away with it, yet it shall be good with the righteous. God will be just. And because sentence against the evil work isn't executed speedily, it's fully set into the hearts of the Son of Man to continually to do evil. Because they think, I'm getting by. You're not getting by. You're storing up treasure. Because when God gives you a space to judge yourself, and you don't judge yourself, according to 1 Corinthians 11:31, God will judge you. And then when those things happen, you can just say, God is just. He said here in verse 3, he said, and thinkest thou this, O man, that judgest them which do such things, and doest the same, that thou shalt escape the judgment of God, or despisest thou the riches of his goodness and forbearance and longsuffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance? Man, I can't tell you the times that I've messed up and just knew that God was going to smoke me down. And he gave me space of repentance to judge myself. Amen? So what will you do? Will you judge yourself, or you say, well, God just had a clause for me? No, he doesn't. He don't have a clause for anybody. Amen? Remember, the ground at Calvary is level. It's level. I'm going to stop right there. I went over and I didn't mean to be so late. We'll pick up in verse, let me find where I am. We'll pick up verse 12 next week. And I appreciate your attention to the Word. God has some nuggets in here that'll help you with your daily walk. I realize you have to work tomorrow and the kids don't have to go to school. That's a good thing, I guess. Amen. But the things that God has put in His Word for you are to help you to fortify yourself, to help you do spiritual warfare, and help you be an overcomer. The sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. The shield of faith, the breastplate of righteousness. Christ is my righteousness. I'm going to heaven not because I'm good enough, but because God made me. Amen. He justified me, saved my soul, sealed me with the Holy Ghost. Amen. Your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Have your loins girt about with truth. Be honest. Amen. Father, I pray, Lord, you give us traveling mercy as we